we don't breathe enough as a family together. When you breathe, that's when you know you're alive. Life is a fantasy. Welcome to another episode of Tiger Belly. I am your captain, Captain Bob. We do have shipmates. Khalyla Kyung.
Did you say shipmates?
She said shipmates.
I said shipmates. Khalyla Kyung, Gilbert, and George. Let me say something right now. Life is a fantasy, and I'm going to tell you this. As a family, I just feel like we don't need to carry around baggage and resentment and hatred in our hearts. I feel like this family is going to work if we just were clear about how we feel about each other. Mm-hmm. I don't want anyone in here. You know, have you heard of the term flower shielding?
Yes, we.
I think
an episode
is called flower shielding.
Yeah, flower shielding.
Can we recap right? though?
Yeah, I don't want to see your face and see a smile, but in your heart, there's anger. Okay? Mm. And I know for a fact there's someone in this room right now that has something to say to me. And I don't like the fact that this fucking bastard comes into my house. You mean with resentment and anger, and he doesn't say anything. He smiles as if we were all good. We're all good in the hood, dog. I'm
trying to forget who it
yeah,
is.
Yeah. And I want to say, I'll just call it out. Georgetown, USA, has something to say to me, uh-oh. And he's not saying it. And I'd like to hear it before we get into this fucking podcast.
Would you like him?
So go to the fucking mic right now. Oh.
Yes.
Yeah,
George.
Get on a mic, Stanopoulos.
Prepare this time, George Stopoulos.
Because I want, before you say anything, George, watch what you say and watch the tone, friend.
Also, can I just say you have to allow the man to speak.
Go ahead.
No interruptions.
No interruptions.
Let him say his piece.
But then, how about this? Once he says his piece, I have to say my piece. And no one interrupts my fucking piece.
Okay.
Because I'm the captain.
Sure.
Go ahead, George.
Firstly, let me say. You're a good friend, Bobby.
Thank you. Well, you lost. Already you lost.
You know, let me tell you a story of back in the day
when I
first came to L.A.
Yeah.
I was a little aspiring producer. It's long before, like, I'd produced videos that had gotten billions of views on YouTube.
Whoa.
Number dropping.
I'd worked with the top new media stars.
Ooh, like Kasim G. Wow. Kasim G. I had no idea. Well, I forgot.
I was a little...
He's not even SAG.
Hey, no interruptions. Let him speak. You're already roasting him, and it's
I know,
like
but he's not even a part
in.
Of any union. But anyway, go ahead.
You know, I was a little unpaid intern at Will Ferrell's company.
Oh.
Wow, just, okay.
You know. I was a...
Go ahead.
I know. And I met a girl there, like, you know, and as guys do when they meet a girl, like, I found out she lived in my neighborhood. I invited her out to drinks, you know. It was a Wednesday tradition, Berrigan's. It's no longer there anymore.
Uh-huh.
But they had $2.50 margaritas, and this was a pretty good time to, like, invite girls to. So she came to this $2.50 margaritas night, Wednesday night at Berrigan's.
Uh-huh.
And we had a great time. We were just chatting. We had so much in common. We were both aspiring producers. We bonded over French New Wave films. We both had master's degrees in producing.
Oh, well, okay.
And then my friends showed up, my good friends. You know, I think they should probably, like, act like good standing humans.
Uh-huh.
You know, my friend Steve, a lawyer, my friend Dick, a doctor, probably, and their significant others as well, Dick's wife, Steve's girlfriend at the time.
Uh-huh.
So they show up, and instead of joining us, as a group, they stand about 10 feet behind me and this girl.
Mm-hmm.
This girl's back is to them. And they proceed to start saying, "Hey, George, hey, George." And then doing this symbol. If you can describe it.
Okay, what George is doing right
going
now,
into a hole.
He does a little, like, a little okay sign with a hole. And he takes his other finger and sticks his finger in the okay sign. Are you saying that that's sexual penetration?
Yes, that's what they were trying to...
Okay.
That's the semaphore they were doing when I was trying to chat with this girl. Yeah. Instead of joining them, I thought, like,
because where I come from, I grew up in the circus. It's It's a tiger running through a circle of flames. Yeah, I grew up in the circus. But anyway, go ahead.
So I keep on trying to like make sure like the conversation keeps going with this girl, so she doesn't turn around and see them like every time they're like, "Hey, George."
Can you
George.
Stop for a second? Just stop for a second. I'm not interrupting you. I just want to say something to Khalyla.
Yes, baby.
Can you look at me right now?
Yeah, baby.
Look at me. I don't know if I can deal with this shit.
You have to come on.
I know, but Steve, look at me right, baby. I'm on the fucking precipice.
Okay.
Of snapping.
Don't snap.
All right.
Go
he
ahead,
hasn't
George.
Said
go,
anything
inflammatory. I know, that's what I'm saying. Oh. So, it's about to happen, and I'm about to fuck. Oh, go ahead.
So, I thought I avoided her seeing anything of my good friends.
Just doing that.
Yeah, being very childish and...
doing the chuk-chuk sign.
Yeah, being very...
Yeah.
Very insensitive to me. Like, we were getting along great. This, I don't know. I might have had a great time with this girl. Who knows?
They were being obnoxious, basically. Yeah. Yeah.
So we all go to another bar. She said she's had enough to drink. And so I walk her to her car. About a week later, I text her. No response. A couple weeks after that, I call her. No response. Mm. I think maybe she had seen my friends. Uh-huh. You know, being good friends. And actually very rude friends.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. Basically, cock blocking me. A couple months later, I finally
it's not cock blocking.
Email her. No response. I'm like, okay, this is not
means.
Going anywhere.
He doesn't even know what it means.
As my good friend, so as I like to say, Bobby.
Yeah.
Okay,
you two are a good friend.
Right. Whoa.
Oh,
because
white rage.
There it is.
White rage. Go ahead. Calm down.
Last week, you may have blown up my personal life, and there is a subset.
Yeah.
There's a section of the female populace who might not like their personal life to be on blast, and in order to have a relationship with me, they might think, oh, Bobby's going to put me on blast. There are many people that may may not like this.
Let him finish.
And so thank you, Bobby.
You're saying, George, let me get this straight. The gist of your story is... You thought Bobby was a good friend when he just really cock-blocked
you. Oh, no, he's just like all my other good friends.
All right, so look at me right now. Look at me right now, my friend.
You're like all my other good friends.
So what happened? You blew it up. He ruined it for you. The girl no longer wants to speak with you. I mean, doesn't want to be in a... she just wants to be friends now.
I'm just saying there's people out there that may... There might be a large group of people. Who knows?
George, this is your problem. When you try to confront somebody about things, be explicit. What did Bobby do wrong? Did he fuck it up for you?
You blew up my fucking joint, dog. Oh, God damn.
There it is.
Sit back down. Sit back down.
Yes, sir.
Okay, go ahead. Oh, this is right here.
Your piece. What's your piece?
There's no piece.
Oh.
Okay. Number one. And I'm stating.
Why is he stating?
Yeah. Number one. Right now, I'm stating facts.
Okay.
Okay.
Facts. Okay. Last week. Let me ask you a question, you fucking got you, my friend. All right?
My good
friend. Did you know I was going to fucking put you on blast last week before the podcast?
I thought I may have been a little friendly.
Yeah, did you look at me right now? Did you know that I was going to talk about it?
Great attorney.
Before the fucking podcast.
Do I know what you're going to say exactly?
No, but you know what the content of what I'm about to say, right?
You might go further than ever imaginable.
But you already knew what I was going to do. So let me tell you guys something right now. Last week, I said that, you know, he's been hanging out with Kalila's friend, Jessica, who is, in Korean, a gishin, a monster.
That's mean.
Yeah. It's not mean. That's fine. All right? If you look at a fucking toad and you don't call it a toad and he says, I'm a Wolverine, you're a toad.
Yeah, you're not a Wolverine.
It's exactly.
You're the only one who ever says that.
What?
She pulled some major, major grade A dick.
Which is, you know, there are mysteries of life. They do TV shows based on mysteries of life.
The Loch Ness Monster.
The Loch Ness Monster and whatnot. Thank you, Gilbert, for fucking backing me up, all right? But there are mysteries of life. Now listen to me right now, okay? You already knew I was going to say, okay? And number two, you are not, and this is what I'm trying to teach you, friend, all right? Right now, I'm being I'm a prophet. I'm your fucking prophet, okay? Don't roll your eyes, bitch.
I didn't roll my eyes.
Don't roll your eyes, bitch.
My mommy saw you.
I want to say this. You're not a closer. And I've been watching you for years. You're not a closer. You can open the game, but you don't know how to close, and I'm teaching you how to close. I want to tell you a story, my friend. May I tell you a story? A long time ago, I owned a skate store. Did you know that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It was called Juvie. It was in Silver Lake. All right? I was part owner with my friend, Callisto. Mm-hmm. One day, I'm working in the skate store, and this girl walks in. Beautiful girl, skate girl. And I go, this right here. I like this girl right here, right? So I took her to dinner, got her number and whatnot, okay? And then like a week later, I go, fuck, it's not, I don't feel it. So I gotta take it to the next level. Mm-hmm. So I took her to Vegas. I took her to Vegas with a bunch of friends of mine, mm-hmm. okay? And this is when I was on drugs. Mm-hmm. So this is over 14 years ago. And I drank, I took some ecstasy. I didn't know where she was. And I opened up the closet of my hotel room, and my friend is fucking her in the closet. I shut the closet and I went back to sleep. I didn't yell at my fucking friend. You know why? Because I didn't claim that shit yet.
You didn't close.
I didn't close the deal. And when the deal is not closed, it's not my product. Okay.
Also, women aren't property.
I'm using it in a business analogy. Mm. I'm not saying that women are property. I'm saying they're all human beings. We have flesh and bones. We have spirits and souls. Okay, that's what I'm saying. All right.
Love,
but what I'm saying is that you, right? You take too long. You don't close the deal, and that should have been yours. You don't ask a girl, "Hey, so I met this other girl. I was wondering if where this is going." She's gonna be like, "Nowhere, dog."
I think you're wrong.
You're not wrong. I'm not wrong. Oh. Tell him how I closed your deal.
I was like, hey,
No reason on God's green earth that I should be dating her. It doesn't make sense in life. It doesn't make sense to the universe or God or anything else, but I did.
I said, hey, I don't think I'm ready to be in a relationship, and I'm actually leaving for London in 2 weeks. He was like, nah, bitch. Nah. You're my girl. You're my girlfriend. Yeah, yeah. You ain't going nowhere. And I was like, wait, what? He was like, yeah, you're my girlfriend. And I was like,
and if she would have gone, it's done.
He's like, nope.
Bye-bye.
You lost.
And I just acquiesced. I said, oh, yeah. I am? He goes, yeah, I've been telling people for a long time you're my girlfriend, so you're my girlfriend.
Yeah.
I was like,
okay. I mean, she probably made a bad mistake. This could have been not the best life for her, but she's in. Okay. So look at me right now, my friend. Look at how fucking angry. Look at his red face.
He's pretty red right now.
Right now.
He's pinker than pink.
He's pinker than pink.
Yeah.
All right.
Which is red.
Which is red. Okay. I really like you, man. I do. We talk about you all the time. We go, God, aren't we lucky to have George on our team? And you come to my shows. You deal with all the, like, the stickers, mailing them out, and I don't even know what's going on. You do everything. That's why this podcast, I'm splitting it four ways down the middle. You know, I know that I'm the bigger star here, and please don't argue against that.
No one's arguing.
All right, I'm the biggest star.
Khalyla might.
Look at me right now. In fact, I want everyone to say it. You're the biggest star. Everyone right now.
On the count of three, all together. Yeah. Bobby Lee, you're the biggest star.
I didn't hear George. Now, George, you say it on your own because I didn't hear you.
Bobby, you're the biggest star.
Good, thank you. Okay. And don't ever drop Kasim G's shit in my fucking room again or any YouTube star. I respect them, okay? They're my peers, but don't threaten me with that stuff. Okay.
Are you done?
Go ahead. I'm not done yet.
Okay,
but I just want to say that I'm sorry.
Oh, now you're sorry?
No, I'm sorry. Here's what I'm sorry about. I'm sorry that you reacted the way you did.
Okay.
And I'm sorry that you didn't close the deal. And I'm sorry that right now you're going to grow and you're going to be a fucking man one day. But you're not a closer, and I want you to learn to be a closer. That's
so
it.
Mean.
And that's the end of the story. You have anything else to say, George?
I have something to say in defend George.
I have something to say too.
Friend,
I think
you
that,
do.
Yeah,
to defend I want to hear this fuckface's thing. First.
One, George is a man.
He is a man, okay. Very much right, so.
Stop. Two, wait. Two, right. How do we know he's not doing the long con?
Fuck a long con, though. You don't get your dick wet with
what
a long
if he's
con.
Not, we don't know if he could probably get his dick sucked all the time. We don't know that. What if he's trying to like, I want the girlfriend.
I no.
No.
Then if that's the I usually can tell if a guy's pulling a long con.
I've seen pictures of his. You've seen pictures of his
long cons. Long cons generally do not work. It's not that's it's science.
I would actually agree. It doesn't work because I was.
It
yeah.
doesn't
I don't think
work.
He knows what a long con.
What you mean?
Yeah.
What I know your, what a long. I used to do long
cons. I used to do long
you
cons. Do?
Yeah, long con is when you meet a girl, you're attracted to her. You know, you go, you know what? I just want to hang out with this girl and I'm going to take my time with it. You know, but you know what a lot of that is fear. Mm-hmm. It's fear of you not making a move and to get rejected. But the thing is that the problem with the long con is long cons always turn into friend zone.
Oh, always.
Oh, almost always turns into friend zone.
And then when she
and when you're in the friend zone, it's almost impossible to get out.
It is. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because once somebody's in the friend zone, because I've been in friend zones and I've also seen other people in friend zones, mm-hmm. you have to then, to save it, mm-hmm. you have to do the reverse. Cut them off completely.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, guys. Can you grab me a tissue? My left nostrils keeps leaking and I keep wiping
it's
it.
Fucking gross. Jesus.
I keep wiping it like this.
Yeah.
I think I have a deviated septum. Only my left nostril keeps leaking. I have I now want to say something about George.
Okay, go ahead.
Like
go ahead. Here you go, babe.
Oh, it's black tissue.
Yeah, go ahead.
You want to see that white snot all over that?
Yeah. Sorry, I'm totally Donald Trumping with my sniffing.
Nice.
I want to say that it's refreshing to see a guy like George who's not pretentious, who's not trying to pull any games, who's actually coming off and actually courting somebody in a very old school kind of way. Not pushy, not aggressive, not angry when she says no. And I can really, really appreciate how he's gone about this. My only constructive criticism about the whole thing is I know my best friend. And my best friend is a tough nut to crack. And she's very feisty. So you almost have to manhandle her in a way where she's like, where you're like, look at me. Look at me.
Yeah.
Not in an aggressive way, but in an assertive way. In a calm assertion because
she's an animal.
I'm an animal. Her and I respond. George, her and I respond to very similar ways of being approached. And it's not in any way like aggressive. It's just really fucking assertive where it's like I know my place in your life and you ought to see it too type thing. That's my only advice, my only tip going forward. I think I would be happy, I said this before, for her to date someone like you, but we gotta feel it in our groin. We gotta feel that fuel just wanting to fuck our loins to want to jump out at you.
Yeah.
And you don't do that without by being meek.
Bobby just spit on his hand and touched Klaus.
Yeah. Now listen.
So nasty.
What does this say? What does it say? What does the sticker say?
It's your sticker that says I declare war on your pussy, sir.
I declare war on your pussy.
Enough said.
War. That's actually a good thing
it's
to
a
take
war.
Away.
And let me say something right now. You have anything else to say to me? That's all you're saying? Long form? Is that all you have
not
to defend?
Well, I mean, I was in the situation on this podcast early on. Get your spot blown up. It's hard to do it when your spot's blown up.
Oh, speaking of which, let's blow Gilbert's spot up a little bit.
I know,
New York.
I know. I'm not done with this yet, but I will get into that.
Okay,
I promise
you. Okay.
You also had another situation where some girl came along at one of the show. Like, you know what I mean? Remember that one other girl?
I didn't like her.
Like her either.
Let's not blow
but
her
what
spot
I'm
up.
I'm not gonna blow her spot up. But what I'm saying is that I feel like he is. It's a thing with him.
Yes,
be in friend zones and not closing a deal and having drinks. No, you have to grab them by the wrist. Not literally.
Okay. Metaphorically. Metaphorically grab them by the wrist.
You gotta grab them by the hair.
Metaphorically, grab by the hair, the nape of the neck.
Metaphorically, and you gotta pull it back.
Metaphorically, pull it back. Really tight, metaphorically.
You're American Indian, you're scalping somebody.
metaphorically,
yeah. Right? And you gotta fucking look them in the eyes and go, take it or leave it. Because I'm gonna take it.
Metaphorically,
everyone listening.
So that's your lesson to learn. And if I ever see you in this situation again, I am going to blow you back up again.
I want to take this moment also to say, on the for the record, if you ever date that girl that you brought around me that ended up hitting on Gilbert,
which
this relationship is over.
Do not talk about that. I dislike her.
We're going to talk about it so deeply.
I dislike her so deeply for you. She is not long conning anyone. She is a con. And I guarantee you that woman to woman, I felt her vibe.
If you ever bring cons into my fucking life and our family, you have another thing coming.
She was.
I don't know why you're angry. But she, I'm all right.
She was hyping him up, having fucking sexting, all this stuff. And then she came to stay in George's place and then fucking hit on Gilbert.
Look at him.
I don't know how to get you out of this.
I'm going to blow her spot up because I just don't like her. Yeah. I don't like her for you, for us.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, I can't tell you what to do, but like, God, don't ever bring that bitch around me again.
So
and that is why George Kimball is George Kimball. Yeah. Long con work.
So to wrap it up, you're forgiven.
To wrap it up, don't wrap it up.
Don't wrap it up.
But I also want you to say I'm sorry. I need to hear I'm sorry from him.
Sorry,
you fucking blew up my joint.
There you go.
Oh, yeah, right.
Stand your ground.
I didn't hear the second part.
Go ahead. Stand your ground.
So about his New York game.
No, he was in New York. Tell us about the wedding. It was your first time in New York.
I was in New York for the first time.
You've never been to New York before.
Never been to New York. Uh-huh. I was there for a wedding. And the first time ever I've been to a wedding with a date that happened to be a romantic partner. That is female, for everyone listening.
That is female.
It's a girl that you're dating
Number
now.
Number one, Asian. So clap, let's just do a slow clap for that.
I thought he was dating a girl, that girl from...
From where?
She does the Soderbergh movies or whatever.
Yeah.
That's her?
Yeah.
The Asian girl?
Yeah.
What's her name?
No, come on.
Just can we do a slow clap? Because remember in the beginning of the podcast, he had never dated an Asian girl.
Look at me before you go on your rage terror
right
now.
I'm not raging out.
I heard you say this at Agahasi. Was it Agahasi?
Agassi Gopchang.
You said... We were talking to George. You're like, look, if you bring a girl in my world, just know I'm going to bring her into my world. So right now, I'm not bringing her into your world.
All right.
Just to keep things safe because I want to make you.
That's fair enough.
You're
going to
meet her in person and then you can decide. No.
If I don't get to know her now, I don't ever want to know her.
Then Khalyla will know her.
Why am I acting like that? You're right. No, you're right. Sorry, baby. Sorry.
That's why you introduced her to mommy first.
I apologize. Which I did. I'm in a.
You me hanging?
Sorry. You had a weird paw like hand.
Because, guys, I apologize for my attitude and where I am. I'm just going through destiny withdrawal.
How's it with you? Have a to go Xbox?
No, we have a rule now.
Ooh,
I don't play on Tuesdays and Thursdays, and I didn't play all day Saturday when Trials of Osiris was going on, and I couldn't finish any of my gold tiers. I didn't get anything, but it's fine. I'm going through my Destiny withdrawal.
We just hit a compromise. He just can't play Destiny two nights out of the week so we can have a movie night. Well, that's not 5 days out of seven. It's pretty fucking good, Bobby.
But you don't need to withdraw. Why would you skip Osiris Saturday?
I don't know why, but I knew that she was mad at me, so I didn't play.
Ooh, interesting.
Well, it started Saturday, and then Sunday, he goes, you can play, and then we made a negotiation.
We did. We struck a deal.
A deal. But I'm going through destiny withdrawal. So I might be a little bit off kilter. Is that a good word?
Off kilter is fine.
Thank you. That's fine.
Okay. So I wanna first off say that I think that I'm the only friend on this side that's actually met your girl.
Uh-huh.
And she seemed like a girl we could hang with. Very nice, well spoken, really seems to care about Gilbert, and she's cute. Like, why wouldn't we be happy for him?
I'm already happy for him.
Yeah, I am too.
We dated.
Can you at least do this for me?
Mm.
May I see a photo?
Not right now.
Whoa. Why? Why?
Okay. No, don't look
she
at
doesn't
doors.
Have social no, media.
Not, one, she doesn't have social media. Because so she doesn't. Also, me single. Talking about, I don't even want to talk about it on this podcast.
That's fine. We're not talking about it.
What? You can't.
We're not talking
that's
about
that's fine.
It.
Show me a picture. And also, put it online.
No, I'm not putting her online. I don't want to talk to her. I'm just saying as a friend, may I see a picture?
Maybe after.
Maybe after.
Now.
No, not now. Because you're not the only one seeing it right now. The whole world, the people that are not my friends in the internet.
Oh, you mean this right here?
Yeah. So
no, that's what I'm saying. I was
going
to hide it. I was going to just put it on the thing. I'll go around. I'll look at her and then I'll come back.
Take my word for it. She's
my
a cute girl.
My girl can meet my friends. Not people looking at this camera.
Yeah. That's fine. See? He has his own rules about his life, sweetie. We don't have to.
You know what it is?
Don't go off kilter right now.
I'm not going off kilter. This is what it is, okay? Maybe we're not there yet.
Maybe not.
I don't think that we're there yet as a family.
You're just a very cruel captain.
I'm not a cruel captain. I'm a good captain.
Called us shit things.
You called us shit mates.
You start at the top, called us shit mates, all of us. And you blew George up.
I understand that. But sometimes the captain, right, has to talk to the crew that way. Mm. Right? Because of the stuff you just did.
What's up?
I'm not going to show you a picture of my phone.
I'm protecting someone else.
Yeah, but I'm not. Okay, fine.
Bobby?
We're not there yet. We're not here yet. We're not there yet. We're not there yet.
Okay, we're not there yet.
We're not close.
We agree.
We're not close, right? We'll have to reevaluate the whole thing.
Okay.
Reevaluate this friendship?
All of it.
But we had such a successful birthday last
week. Oh, last week.
Whose birthday was it?
What was that? Oh my God, Bobby.
Whose birthday?
It was your shipmate's birthday.
Yes,
it was our ship's birthday.
Our first live podcast.
That we haven't talked about it yet.
No, we haven't.
So this is the podcast.
I want to say this. May I say something?
Yes, you may.
What a surprise. What a night. I went to a place that they held auditions for some sort of industrial film for some Southwest airline thing. So that you walk in and there's people signing up to audition. And we had our podcast in an audition room. Mm-hmm. So when I first showed up there, I was going to...
You're grumpy.
Grumpy. I was going to burn the place down. But when I walked in, it changed everything. And it made me feel gleeful and really excited about
what did
what
you
we're
see?
Doing.
What was it like walking
in the
room?
I saw a bunch
room?
Of people that really liked our podcast. And that... it makes me want to cry right now, but... You know that. And the podcast was fun. I got to talk to people and whatnot. Mm-hmm. And then this weekend, I was at the new Levity Live Comedy Club in Oxnard. And these two kids from Long Beach who are TigerBelly fans showed up. And I took them to Denny's afterwards. But the reason why I did is because anybody that listens to this podcast is just a different fan than regular fans. They're more family than other ones.
How great was every single person in that room last week?
Awesome.
I mean, everybody was just
amazing.
Fucking amazing, kind, and fun. And they were funny.
Funny.
Yeah. You know, and they were smart, and they were just very, like, interactive. And, you know, some there were a few that were introverted, but you can tell, like, the wheels were spinning
in
their head.
Yeah.
It's such a fucking fun bunch.
It felt good.
Yeah.
It felt really good. There was that half Latino girl in the front. She was cool.
Bianca.
The white dude that brought the pizza.
Phil.
Like him a lot.
Phil.
There was
the
lady
from
the law office from San Diego.
Oh, yeah.
Who, Sarah?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know all the names?
It's crazy how I know them all by name.
Also,
now.
Joe, the one whose butt Bobby wanted to climb into, the big guy.
Yeah, Joe.
Super
funny.
There was a guy in there that he was a big guy.
Yeah.
Rotund.
Rotund, yeah.
Rotund.
And I wanted to just open his butt cheeks and walk in. I just lived it forever.
Not metaphorically.
And not in a sexual way, but just in a.
He was very pillowy, very, very welcoming. Like his body, you just definitely wanted to lay in.
Yeah, that was a very good, a very nice experience. And in general, TigerBelly fans have been just a delight.
Nothing but supportive.
Yeah.
They get occasionally, they get they don't know how to express their love, so they say mean things. But George and I came up with a conclusion that people just express love in different ways. So if they, even if it's something that may seemingly be offensive, they're just, that's their way of showing interest in you, and I'm okay with that.
Yeah. And even like Jade did the weekend with me at Levity Live.
At Oxnard.
And a lot of TigerBelly fans obviously like her, and she, I would like to really do a podcast with Khalyla, Jade, and Asa or something. Girl. All women's podcast.
Yeah.
You can be our honorary woman.
No, I don't want to do it. I want to produce it, but I would like to be there, but I don't want to be on it.
Beat out the view.
Yeah. On to a not so good note. Tell us what happened on Sunday in Oxnard on your final show with a guy sitting in the front. The what? Down syndrome guy. Not the Down syndrome guy, but.
Oh my God, yeah. So, you know, I have a joke about. I have a joke that I tell.
You don't have to say it. Just no, I'm, I'll
just, just give you the gist of the joke.
The week.
But there was the joke I have where I have a joke about people Down syndrome having sex.
Oh, I think I heard.
Yeah, yeah. And so I'm about to tell the joke, and this older man in the audience in the front row goes, "My son has Down syndrome."
He has tears in his eyes.
Tears in his eyes. And I look at him, I go, "You're being for real?" "Yeah. He has Down syndrome." I go, "Fuck. Well, I hope you enjoy the joke."
What else? That's the answer. That's,
I mean, you can't stop.
Yeah.
Listen, I tell comics this all the time. Is if you have a joke where you can't tell it in certain rooms because of who's in the room, they should never tell the joke. Because, you know, it's just not, then it's offensive.
It shouldn't be on your set.
But if I'm going to tell it, I'm going to tell it no matter who's in the room. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, I believe in the joke. Mm. And I believe in
America.
And I believe in free speech and all that stuff.
Yeah.
So it wasn't going to stop me from telling the joke, but it didn't go well.
Yes, it did.
Well, it did, because at the end, yeah, he did laugh.
Hysterically. It's just that the rest of the audience felt bad.
Uncomfortable. So
they were kind of like uncomfortable.
No, the whole audience, while I was saying it, they were going, "No, no.
Don't say it."
They all felt bad. They all felt bad.
But
yeah.
He was laughing.
So at the end, at the very end, though.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
At the very end. Because I'd go into the sex moves.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And it got to him. But I tell a joke about Alzheimer's. It's kind of not really nice, but some people don't like it. I mean, it's like you can't write jokes, you know, based on how people are going to feel about it. Mm-hmm. I don't care.
Yeah.
I mean, I care about people's lives and it's hard. But if I think something is funny, I'm just going to do it, you know? And this whole thing about, like, I'm not really into, you know, the whole thing about bullies and all that. I like bullies.
Because you are a bully.
No, I'm not a bully.
You yourself.
I was always bullied.
I was bullied too.
I was bullied brutally in high school. And I thank those bullies. I want to tell kids that are being bullied in high school, go, listen, like nerds. Hey, nerd. Yeah, it's tough now. But when in your 20s, that bully is going to be a doorman at a club, and you're going to make millions of dollars.
You're going to throw a wad in.
Yeah.
Lot of cash.
What I'm
in
saying
his face.
Is that life changes and it shifts, and bullies generally don't. They turn into. There's a comic, Michael Lonoci, who's Chris D'Elia's opener.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Lonoci, I feel like he could have been a bully in high school, right?
Like bro-y?
He's just jockish.
But that's why I treat him like shit. Because I know that I speak for. The bullied, the nerds. Mm-hmm. And you seem to think that I'm not a bully. What you just said that I was a bully?
Yeah.
You're
an adult bully.
You think that I'm a bully?
I think you bully some of us.
Nah.
Nah, I don't give a fuck.
Nah.
Nah, man.
True bully.
That's not true bullying. You don't even know what bully means then. Because my shit's love.
Oh, hard love.
That's not even hard love. It's pure love.
Oh, it's pure, the purest kind.
Yeah, yeah. If you saw, if love... in physical form is me.
Mm. Oh, wow. Also, check out Love on Netflix season 2 coming out.
Which I'm terrible on.
You stop saying that.
I just saw it. It's terrible.
Something.
I'm a bad actor.
No, you're fine.
I was just on, Son of Zorn.
You were
terrible
very funny
in it.
No, you weren't.
And then she went to the premiere of Late in America, and she hated me in it.
Oh, speaking of that, the internet went a little crazy.
You were really good in it.
He was very good.
Who said it?
Barb Baker.
Who's that?
He was also in the movie.
Yeah. Everyone says that. Every single person says that you're really good in the movie, except for this bitch right here. She goes, I don't believe it. I can't see it.
That's not what I said.
Your accent sucks. You're misquoting everything
me.
About
oh,
it.
Oh, my Lord, you're misquoting me.
And then I go into a depression. I go outside, I have a cigarette, and go,
what the fuck I said.
My career's over.
I don't like it when he does an accent. I just can't get past it. I feel like the part would have been just as funny as him being an Asian American with a mother with an accent. I just didn't think it was necessary.
But it's not his choice.
It's not his choice. And I know that they asked me to do it.
And I said, what am I going to do? I don't want to do this movie.
You're acting. You were hilarious. I just can't get past an accent. You know me. I'm so weird about shit.
Yeah,
like
but
that.
You know what? I mean, still, there's a nicer way to do it. Because I'm going to do a depression. You know what I mean? I went into a deep depression about it. And I'm like, should I change, not ever act again?
And he
again?
Was so angry at me at the red carpet.
Why did you say that at the red carpet, though?
I didn't say it at the red carpet. I said that afterwards. But he didn't even stay for the movie. I watched it at home because like I feel like...
We left the movie. Which was, I'm sorry, anyone that has anything to do with the movie. We just sat there and we're like, this movie's not going to start.
Yeah.
And we're right next to the producers and, you know, the two stars.
Yeah.
And I'm like, let's get out of here. So we snuck out.
Ooh,
nice. And then they said, where would you go? And I go, she has a heart condition. I blamed it on her heart.
That's a good girl.
Which it sucks having Khalyla with a heart condition, but you still use it.
Yeah,
you use it.
Yeah.
But the movie itself had very, very funny parts. Like parts where I like genuinely laughed.
The internet though, on Instagram, went crazy for that picture of you and Bobby on the red carpet talking about your abs. You told me something really funny when you walked in here is that Bobby said he wished I never had abs and wished.
Yeah, we were in bed earlier. He's like, I fucking hate your abs. He's disgusted by my abs. Why do you hate my abs?
Because maybe it's the thing I'm trying to get you not to be desirable.
Oh.
To take you off the market.
Ooh. Abs are not necessarily desirable to a lot of men. I know a bunch of my dude friends who don't like very defined abs. They like the more, you know.
Yeah.
But he was very, very upset at me while we were walking the red carpet. No, actually, while he was walking the red carpet.
Yeah, here's another thing. So we might get invited to the Keeping Up with the Joneses premiere, okay? Mm-hmm. And if that's the case, you're going to fucking walk the red carpet with me.
Yeah.
That's the whole point, but not this last one. She's like, I'm going to just go. She left.
I didn't. I was waiting at the side. I didn't want to be photographed that day.
Doesn't matter. You think I did? You just have to do it.
I just have, you know, my anxiety and stuff.
Yeah, you think I hate it. I hate it myself, but you have to do it.
I should have suffered with you.
Yeah.
And I should have like stood.
You hung out with Sid Wilder, your new friend, and, you know what I mean? And you did your thing.
Hashtag
you know?
Podcast celebrity.
Yeah.
But thank you for casting me in that movie.
It was cute. It was a cute movie for sure. I have nothing bad to say about it.
But you said that the Keeping Up with the Zorn was okay with me in it.
Son of Zorn?
So whatever that show's called.
I thought you were the funniest part of that episode.
Okay.
Yeah, I thought you were really cute. Go ahead.
No. I mean, I like the show. I mean, I don't watch things that I'm in.
I know you don't.
I hate it.
I know. And that's why we had to leave the movie.
We left the movie.
But before that same day, which was last Wednesday, I had to jump out of an Uber in the middle of an intersection.
Yeah.
What? Why?
I jumped into an Uber with a very rageful driver. Like he went into a full fucking rage and I had to jump out of the car. So he picked me up and he seemed a little bit like, he was already in a bad mood and he couldn't, when you enter the car, the driver has to hit start or passenger is in the car,
pick
right?
Up,
so that that way, or pick up that way, you know, they can charge you the money, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I guess he didn't pay his phone bill. So right when I got into the car, he couldn't charge me for the ride. And I realized what was happening because Google Maps wasn't working. His Uber app wasn't working. So I said, hey, you know, sir, just like close down all your apps and maybe start it up again and maybe it'll work, you know? And it didn't work. So I struck a deal with him. I was like, you know what? I was like, looks like you're having a bad day. I'll pay you. The fare was only supposed to be $5. It was only like 3 miles away. And I was like, I'll give you $20. I was like, just get me to where I need to be. I thought was the nice guy's having a bad day, right?
What do you say?
Midway through the trip, I because I was using the maps on my phone for directions. I was like, let's just use my phone. Don't worry about it. He starts pounding on his steering wheel like, fuck this bullshit. And I,
so the horn's honking?
Yeah, like getting angry. And he's like, where the fuck I go next? He's like asking me for directions. I was like, oh, you're going to make a left on Highland? Wow. And I was like, sir, I'm just trying to help you. Like, you know? And then I was like, hey, make a left here, but you might want to go stay on the right lane. Trying to give him tips, you know? And he raised his fucking hand like this. I'm sitting in the back. And he's like, I know how the fuck Franklin works. Like, he tried to shush me. In the middle of the fucking intersection, I had $10. Because I knew that if I... He was probably not... He seemed dangerous to me.
Yeah.
If I didn't pay him, I knew he was the type to chase my ass down. So the fare was only supposed to be $5. I threw him a 10 and I fucking jumped out of the car. And I filed a complaint to Uber and they have not responded to me at all. But I screenshotted everything. And I was stuck in the middle of Hollywood because I couldn't even get another Uber because his app had frozen. So I couldn't, like, my Uber.
Exit out of
yeah,
yours.
I couldn't exit out of mine.
How many star, what was the star rating?
4. So you know something bad must have happened because a 4-star rating is actually not as
well.
Very
when
good.
I remember I went to the Norm Macdonald thing, that happened to me too.
Oh really?
With an Uber driver?
Yeah, I mean Norm Macdonald has his show, right? So it was in Venice, and they go, we got a car, so they picked me up, and halfway during the ride, I don't know what happened, but the ticket was lost or disconnected or
yeah.
So then he just pulls over on Venice Boulevard. It broke. Get out. I go.
That's not how it
works. Yeah, but I didn't even know it was an Uber.
Mm-hmm.
They did it.
They sent it for
me. They sent it for me, right? I go, yeah, okay, well, I have like $100 in my pocket, so just drive me to the place and I'll pay you. No, broke. Get out. I go, and then I'm calling the guy, right? Mm-hmm. And then the producer of the thing, and they're like, oh my God. And I'm sitting in a car now with this guy on the side of Venice Boulevard. And we're not moving, and I have to tape this thing. So we have to get there. Mm-hmm. But finally, like, you know, after about 15 minutes, they called him and they arranged it. But he was visibly angry. And so the second half of it was like an angry drive.
You were in danger, basically.
So Uber's got to fix that.
It's not, most of the time, look, 99.999% of all my Uber rides are perfectly uneventful. It's just, the one thing I would appreciate is, look, like, I'm a chick, right? Mm-hmm. That guy was obviously dangerous. In some type of, like, aggressive mode. And the fact that I felt so unsafe that I had to jump out of the car is, I deserve a response at the very least.
What I'm saying is this Uber, right, to their drivers that have that kind of, like, when customers have that kind of experience, the consequences should be very severe.
Yeah, not like, okay, one strike.
Like, no strikes. No, out. Because it's like, because for me, I'm not an Uber guy.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know much about it. I've taken them because I don't trust it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Like, I'd rather take a cab.
But there's supposed to be background check.
Wait, I said cab. What's the face about, George?
You prefer a cab to an Uber?
Yeah,
well,
because
I will say
for
cabs
me,
are more screened. The drivers are screened
more.
Yeah,
first of all,
I thought
cab,
they go through the same background
with
check.
With cab? Mm-hmm. I know for a fact that I'm going to get to my destination. I know for a fact, I have never been in a cab on the thousands of cabs I've ever been to where they pulled over and said, get out.
Yeah.
This is just two stories between us two. That shit's never happened. Because with a cab, they're a part of a company and they could get fired.
Yeah, you lose your medallion.
Do you want to hear a fun tidbit about
No, I want to finish this with him. So now, are you shaking your head, fucker?
No, I've had nothing but great experiences with Uber.
It's like it comes out in everything that he does now, and he can't get over this Jessica thing. She doesn't like you, dude.
Don't say that.
He'll get over it. Positive energy.
She loves you.
She wants to marry you. She wants to suck your dick.
Can you explain to me this? When we were younger, my sister and I, we didn't have a family car in the Philippines, but we had an unmarked taxi that drove us with when we had a driver, his name was Manoy Cesar.
Okay.
And it was an unmarked taxi that didn't have a meter, and that was our car for like 8 years.
You had a driver.
I know, but why did my dad insist on making it look like a taxi?
You want to be pretentious.
Yeah, he doesn't want to look like you guys are
a rich white girl.
But you were.
Yeah.
That's so strange.
While people were eating beetles outside, you had an unmarked taxi. Yeah. Getting free rides everywhere.
He refused to have just a regular
car. But that reminds me of a story. I don't know why, but it's a little dark. But when I was a kid, my mom picked me up from camp. And all the kids, they get off of the bus, this bus, and they go to their moms and they hug their moms, you know, because we've been gone for 2 weeks or whatever. And I remember approaching my mom and she came to hug me and I pushed her.
Wait, why would
you? Yeah, yeah.
Why? How would you
do that?
Why?
How old were you?
I don't remember, like 8, maybe 9 or something. And I remember, like, we're in the car, and my mom backhanded me.
Yes.
30 fucking times.
Good.
The Asian style.
Like, but no, like, hard hits.
Good.
Oh, not like your little, no, like, scary, no, like, scary.
Backhand. Pap.
Good.
Pap.
Deserved.
Pap. And for, like, days, I just never left the room. I was, like, it was summertime, and I was just crying and trembling.
Good.
I don't know why I did that, though.
Yeah, you're a little shit.
No, if I think we've all done stuff like that. I've called my mom. I don't know why. She gave me the wrong, when I was like 7, she gave me the wrong hamburger. I asked for a Wendy's Junior Bacon Cheeseburger. She gave me one without bacon. And she ate it, took a bite, and I saw it. And I said, "You're such a fatso." And then she looked. I don't know why. Like that, she looked at me and said, "What the fuck did you say?"
Yeah.
She dragged my arm into a dark room. I don't know why it had to be dark.
Yeah.
She pinched me.
Between my cheeks,
Till the fucking nails touch. I just have blood. Like I pierced my cheek.
I love it. I love when parents
don't call
your
mom a fatso.
Yeah.
At least you guys got hit because you deserved it.
Yeah, you got hit a lot.
I got hit for fun.
For sport.
No, my mom was going through some things, you know, but let me tell you something. I don't hit my dog. I don't ever hit people in general. But if I had a 16-year-old daughter who came home and said, "Fuck you, you stupid cunt bitch."
Knockout.
Oh, my God. I will grab that. I will snatch her by the fucking hair, and I will drag her through the neighborhood and shame her like Cersei.
Oh, my Cersei. God. So what do you guys think about parenting when your kids? Are you gonna inflict? Do we want to do that kind of punishment?
But when you I like that scenario.
Okay.
But I'm going to tell you what a 16-year-old, like, I was that 16-year-old.
Oh,
okay,
God.
Do it. Okay, right? Okay, he'll be coming
home. So this is what, if I was a girl, right, and you grab my hair,
yeah,
this is what I would do. So you grab my hair.
Well, say it to me first.
Get her angry.
Hey, mom, you're a fucking cunt.
Oh, yeah? I didn't hear you.
Oh, I'll say it.
Oh, shit. Uh-huh.
You're a cunt.
Oh, shit.
Okay, then you hit me, right? You know what I would do?
Yeah.
As that rebellious 16-year-old? All right, I parked my shit.
No. But I wouldn't just hit you. I wouldn't even let you go. I would snatch you like this.
Yeah.
And I would fucking knee you.
Yeah, in the face. In the face.
In the fucking mouth. In the face. Mouth.
Yeah.
I would knee you. I would Muay Thai clinch you, and I would just knee you.
Knee.
I would do to Rich Franklin what
Anderson Silva
did to Rich Franklin.
All right, so okay.
Break
after that
nose.
Beating,
yeah.
What I would do is, all right, you know, touche, and then I would,
with a bloody eye.
I would go to my room.
Yeah.
Pack my stuff,
yeah,
and never see you again.
No, you wouldn't.
I think 16-year-olds are scared to do,
like, because I, as a 16-year-old, if you and I had a kid,
yeah,
I think our 16-year-old would be kind of cute. So I'll be like, you know what? I'm gonna use my pussy and take advantage of some shit.
No, I think that
that's what Dad taught me. Yeah. Use my pussy to get some shit. My dad is Bobby Lee.
Oh my God.
Parenting is tough, man, because I feel like you're going to be the enemy one way or the other, you know?
Yeah.
You guys will do good cop, bad cop, right? Or both?
Oh, he better be on board.
No, I'm
sure a good cop.
For sure.
That's sure a good cop.
For sure.
It's going to be a
reason. Mom just needs you. Here's $3,000. Let's go to Barney's. Yeah. And then me and my daughter are at Barney's shopping.
I'm Mutai Clinch you too.
Yeah, we both have black eyes, my daughter and I.
Father and daughter.
Yeah, walking around with bloody faces, black eyes, with a lot of merch. You know what I mean? Just bags of.
That is the one thing I require out of a father and a husband.
What?
Is that you have to, and I will show you the same respect, you have to co-sign with my decisions, and we have to stand firm together.
You know, it's like.
Not that good cop, bad cop.
That's why I'm like, I'm right now. I mean. I know this, that if we had kids, you and I, the whole family would be under your leash.
Why does that have to be a leash?
Leash.
I think we would all be kind of like
person.
Tiptoeing around, you know what I mean? Where is she?
Like a horror film.
Yeah, yeah.
Son, where is she? She's out in the garden. Okay, let's go. Let's go.
You know? Because we're so scared of making the wrong move.
You'll be powerful, though.
I don't need to be friends with my children while I raise them. We can be friends later down the road. They'll get it. They'll respect me.
You wouldn't
more
be friends with me
road.
Either?
If you're not on my side, I will treat you like my child.
Okay, give me an example.
Wait, I treat you like my child. All right,
I want to give you an example of, okay, so Gilbert's our kid.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So what would something he'd be do? Let's say he.
I got in a fight at school.
No, he's got, we get a call from a school mm-hmm. saying that they found weed in his backpack.
Oh, weed.
All right. And he's kicked out of school for a week.
Okay.
What I would do?
Yeah.
I do weed. Mom.
If you're going to do that, don't bring it to school. I don't disagree with you experimenting with drugs.
Oh, cool. Sweet.
But I think that we can probably do that in a way where you don't get in trouble with school and other authority figures. So let's do it in a more controlled setting. I'm not against it, but let's do it the right way. Let's be smart about it. Let's be responsible about your weed smoking, because the society hasn't caught up to marijuana use yet. So in the meantime, let's just be smart about where we bring it and where we smoke it.
Smoke it here.
Yeah.
Every day.
He's 16.
By the time I have a 16-year-old, marijuana laws would have been changed.
I'm going to say that. Listen. What's your name?
Dad, what the fuck?
You don't know your own son's name?
Jojo.
It's Gabriel.
Gabriel.
Yeah.
Gabriel. Okay, yeah. Number one, you're 16.
Mm-hmm.
In my house, I just want you to follow the law. Not the law of my house, the law of the country. All right? Okay. So I don't want you to be drinking in my house.
Okay.
You're not 21, mm-hmm. right? I don't want you to just be smoking weed in my house.
Mm-hmm.
You're not 18 or whatever, how old you need to be to get it, right? The medical marijuana. You have to be 18, right?
I think so.
Yeah, right? So you're just going to follow the rules of the law.
What if I don't want to?
If don't, then you're going to be cut off from me, all right? And you're going to make me an enemy, and I'm going to make your life very difficult.
I'm sorry, Papa.
Okay.
Then you're more the disciplinarian then, because
that
I'm a little
bit more.
That was
really good. That was
in that situation, I mean, no, but I'm not being a discipline there. I'm just saying.
You are.
I don't want illegal shit going on in my house. Don't kill anybody. Don't rape anybody. This
but
is my house.
You know kids are going to do it anyway. So it's like, at least let him know, okay, you're going to do it whether I say not to. Whether I allow it or don't, right? You're going to do it. So at least let's hatch a plan to where you don't get caught for your shit.
See, now you're a bad parent.
I'm not a bad parent. He's
going to
do
bad parenting.
It anyway.
No.
Son, be responsible. Don't be a fucking idiot
no,
about where
I'm gonna
you smoke your shit.
Stop again then. Stop again, lady. Yeah. Okay? Look at me, son.
Yeah.
Gabriel. You also know that alcoholism and drug addiction runs through our family.
We'll talk about that.
No.
He just...
It runs through our family. Your Uncle Steve has it.
Okay.
I have it. Your grandfather has it. Mm-hmm. Alcoholism. All right. So as long as you're living in this house, you're not going to drink or do drugs or anything. At 18, when you leave, you can do whatever you want.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But not in my house.
Okay.
Okay. That's it.
Okay. He's going to do it anyways.
I don't know.
Okay, and then he's gonna bring out my dad and me, and he's gonna get beat by a golf club.
Oh, Mom, I don't want that. Can I just listen to Dad?
Yeah, then maybe you are more of a disciplinarian than me. I
think maybe I am.
That actually was very. It was like flipped how I thought it would
be. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, because I don't suffer from an addiction. I've always had relatively good control of like what I experimented with, and I'm sort of a square anyway. So I don't know. The fear of spiraling out of control like you. So you probably fear that for your own son, whereas I don't necessarily because I never experienced it. So I get where you're coming from.
Yeah, the thing is that I'm just scared of the disease part of it, you know, because I just feel like it's in
my genetics,
mm-hmm. right? So I you know, when a kid is born to an alcoholic family, when their parents are an alcoholic, they still might have the gene, and so inevitably they will just become an alcoholic. I don't think it's avoidable, but I still want my kid to know that even if it isn't, if you're an addiction, that there is a way out. Like I have friends in AA that their dad and moms have 50 years of sobriety in AA. Mm-hmm. So they, you know, they would do their drugs and stuff, but inevitably they knew how to reach out and get sober.
Oh, I have a really good question about that. So when you have a child and you, let's say for instance, someone like you, you're very well aware of your addiction. Do you share that early on with your child, or does it become, do you have a fear that it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy for him? No. Where it's like, well, my parents are addicts, so yes, I have a higher propensity. So they resign to the idea of addiction versus never telling them. And perhaps there is no self-fulfilling prophecy where they don't automatically, if life is going bad, you're like, well, it's in my genetics anyways, because you know how teenagers are so full of shit, they're so hormonal, they don't necessarily like think, they think that they, oh, I'm just predisposed to it, so yeah, I am a fuck up, you know.
You bring your kids to meetings.
You do?
Yeah.
Early on,
like scared straight, show them.
No, you just no. If I had a kid and I was like, hey dad, let's go have lunch, yeah, okay, but you have to go to this meeting with me. So we sit in the A meeting, right, for 1 hour. I'll take you to wherever you want to eat lunch. Mm-hmm. If you want to go get ice cream, we can get ice cream. And then we go home. My point is that you do it like as if, you know, you tell them about the disease. You say, your father has a sickness and it's called alcoholism. I know I haven't drank or done drugs in a very long time, but I have to maintain my recovery.
Would you be open about telling him all your monster stories?
Well, I mean, not like...
Pick and choose, right?
Yeah, I'll pick and choose. I mean, I don't know how old that person is, the kid is, but... You know, I just think that you just have to be honest, you know, but yeah, I think I would be the disciplined then.
Yeah. Person.
But not in terms of grades and stuff.
Why? No?
I don't care about grades.
I don't know if I care about grades so much as they can show me that they're learning things and they're showing some type of like real like effort and discipline. Discipline's a big thing. Work ethic is a big thing for me. If you have to have it, you have to kind of instill that very early on. You can't just get by doing nothing, Bobby. You can't.
I understand. I know, but the thing is that you should, like when Deepak Chopra raised his kids, he said that he didn't tell them to go to Princeton and or Harvard.
No.
He didn't care. He didn't say you have to get straight A's.
No.
He said, help other people.
Yeah.
You know, and become a good person. Mm-hmm. I think that's very important because look what happened to Cho Sung Wei, Virginia Tech. Mm-hmm. That kid, you know, pressure, had very good grades.
Yeah.
Their parents owned a laundromat, I believe.
Yeah.
He had a sister that went to NYU or something. Mm. And he...
Cracked.
No, he got good grades, but he didn't have any friends.
Yeah.
If my kid didn't have any friends at all...
Be word.
And had no social life...
Yeah.
...at all... and would talk to things that aren't there, mm-hmm. I'm more concerned about that.
Yeah, that's my biggest fear.
My biggest fear is like when that kid from Santa Barbara, it's the kid that shot up Santa Barbara.
Yeah, that entitled little boy.
What's his name?
Elliot Rogers.
Elliot Rogers. You know, his dad was white. His mom was Asian. Mm-hmm. His dad's a director.
Yeah, mom is, I think.
No, his dad is, right? And a real director. And... Now, you can see photos of the mom and dad when they first find out about
the kid shooting. That he had shot up all those kids?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the photo of the mom, there's a photo of his Asian mom, and her eyes are like red and teary, mm-hmm. and there's a sense of severe shock mm-hmm. and horror. You can see it online. Mm-hmm. I don't ever want to have that face.
Yeah.
Because that right there, it's over. Whatever my life, you know, is or was, it's all going to be based on that moment.
That's also my biggest fear. And I've actually talked to my doctor about this in terms of procreation. I'm so afraid of raising a child with any type of like severe mental illness because I don't know. Like, I just think that would be so difficult. Mm-hmm. You know, something like maybe I can probably tackle depression and anxiety and talk him, you know, through those stages. But when it comes to real hardcore stuff like schizophrenia.
Do you have schizophrenia in your family?
I don't have any schizophrenia. Me either. But we have a lot of like, you have addiction. I have mental illness like depression and anxiety in my family.
Yeah, but we don't have like the severe ones in your family.
No, but depression's pretty bad too. And sometimes the... I don't know. I fear that maybe our cross is going to...
Oh, so alcoholism, though, isn't a bad thing. I believe that my brother and I can't speak for my brother. I know he feels this way. Are glad that we have the disease because it taught me how to live a better life. Without me having the disease, I wouldn't know the things that I know, the tools, like living in the moment and wanting to be a better person or whatever. So it's like, if I was just a regular guy, I just wouldn't have the tools that I have now. And I'm glad I have those tools. And so I don't think that it's a, if I had a kid with alcoholism or drug addiction, my only prayer would be so that they would, you know, have a spiritual awakening, you know, and get why they need to get sober. But once they're in the like 12 step stages, I would just be delighted, I think. You know, but
so no Muay Thai clinches then.
Don't Muay Thai clinch your kids.
Muay Thai clinch your kids, guys.
And I'll see a photo of your girlfriend eventually.
No. What do you think about the new Westworld?
He hasn't seen it yet.
Oh, you haven't seen it yet. No. But he's been talking about it even before you guys mentioned it.
Well, I like the movie.
So tell us. I don't even know. I've never seen it.
Well, the movie was a B movie, and it's about a theme park, and the theme park has robotic cowboys and cowboys in it.
Yeah.
And so I guess you just go and I haven't seen it in so long, but and then one of the robots goes haywire and starts killing people.
Okay.
But when I look at the trailer for this new Westworld, I think there's more to it, way more to it than that. But I just like anything sci-fi. I think that anything HBO does generally
pretty good.
Is good. So I'm excited about it. And I also saw, we also saw a great movie the other
Ooh,
day.
Ooh, we finally saw Train to Busan.
And I'm telling you right now, dude, I'm not kidding you, dude. Anyone listening to this, if you like The Walking Dead, if you like really good movies, this is the movie to watch.
Great zombie
it's
movie.
It's so good. The it Korean really one? Is.
It's only limited release, right?
Yeah, Korean zombies are...
Fast or slow?
Fast as fuck.
Fast.
Fuck that shit.
Fast as fuck.
I hate
That's
them.
The worst ones.
Yeah, and they're also...
And the turnover is even faster.
They're just a scary... When Asians do anything demonic...
It's scary as fuck. Zombies, it's scary as fuck.
Scarier, yeah.
Like World of Z was like, okay, they're fast.
Yeah.
But like,
yeah, but when Asians get possessed... Because we already... Like if Jessica got possessed... that would be the scariest movie ever made. I would literally like never sleep again. Like the 15 Jessicas. If that movie, oh my God.
28 Days Later really freaked me out.
Yeah, that one. Infection.
Super fast. It's kind of similar. Yeah. The acting was really good in it too. Really, really good.
And also, there was moments of like the girl that they cast in Train to Busan.
The little girl?
Was very good.
She was really good.
Very good. And I just like the dynamic of characters in it. Mm-hmm. The types of characters that were in it were believable to me.
Yeah.
There was a businessman that was a piece of shit in it.
Yeah.
I really like the movie a lot, and I really think that people should watch it. How are we doing on time, Gilbert?
We're over 50. Let's do a question.
What number are we?
50. Oh, 1 hour.
Mm-hmm. We're right at
let's
an
do,
hour.
Let's do this question then.
Unhelpful advice with Bobby and Khalyla.
Ooh.
My name.
I like that one.
That's the same, right?
Yeah.
My name is Miles. I'm 18. I'm meeting my girlfriend's parents next Friday, but I'm black and they're white and pretty racist. Any unhelpful advice? Thank you. Well, sorry.
In a situation like that, you're carrying your whole race on your shoulders.
Oh, God.
And whatever you do dictates, you know.
Hell no. Oh, I have a complete different answer to that. Go ahead.
Would you just fucking let me finish, bitch?
Yeah, go ahead.
The number one thing is this, is that I dated Sarah Hyland, mm-hmm. not the girl from Modern Family, another one, a comic. Mm-hmm. She's from the South. Parents white. Mm-hmm. Grandparents are like deeper South.
Okay.
Yeah. Right? Old school. Yeah.
They don't like ching chongs.
You build railroads.
But I know as a survivor in relationships, the most important thing is for the parents to like you. And I do it, like, when I even met Jade's parents in Virginia, her boyfriend, Nick Rutherford's parents, I met them in Oxnard. Mm-hmm. Any parents, I'm so good at it. I think it's important. Mm-hmm. It's important to have parents like you. And so this black kid, right? I'm sorry to say it, but you're going to have to play the game. And you're going to have to be what they want you to be. Mm. Don't go in there going, I'm going to be myself. No. Be like my brother. A changeling.
A changeling?
Yeah, we're changelings.
Oh.
All right. So play the fake game.
It's not even fake. It's just be the best guy you can be of you. Like, for instance, it's like, let's say you're a parent, mm-hmm. okay? I'm meeting you for the first time. Mm-hmm. You're George's dad.
Wow.
That's what he would say.
Hello. Hi. I'm,
yeah. What's George's last?
I'm Mr. Kimmel.
Hello, Mr. Kimmel. Muhammad Ali, my friend.
Yeah. Hello, Mr. Kimmel. I'm Bobby. I work with George.
Oh. I heard you blew up my son's spot up last week.
Yeah, but, you know, that's all a part of the podcast. You told him?
George?
You told him about the podcast?
George, don't get red in front of our grass again.
I don't want to meet George. Yeah. I don't want to meet that guy, so it's going to... Fuck it. Fuck what I'm saying. Hey, yeah, yeah.
What is your way of handling this, Khalyla?
If they're racist, you can do nothing right. So just go in there as yourself. Whether you're perfect, whether you show up as the most subservient fucking butler, or if you show up as fuck, if you came down as a Jesus himself and showed yourself in a black man's body, that's not, it's not, they're fucking racist.
That's not true.
Listen to me.
That's not true.
It's not going to change their mind.
It is. Because when I went to the South, right, the grandmother was sitting there, right, knitting, okay? I knew that there was, you know, there could have been a thing. Like, she just, it could feel
the energy, yeah.
Tension, right? And I go, oh, it's a beautiful grand piano you have. It was at her grandma's house. She, yeah, nobody plays it. No one in the family plays
Boom.
It.
Boom.
Ding. Boom.
Gotcha.
Ding, right? May I try your piano? Well, I don't even know if it worked or not. And I go, let me, can I?
Crack.
And then I just played a little tune. She, wow, it's wonderful. I go, yeah, my parents, we had a grand piano at home growing up, and you know, they're really strict, you know, my parents, so they made me take, you know, you find ways into their fucking heart.
Yes, yeah. Of course, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is go in there, be good, be kind, be respectful, because those are her parents. You do want, but don't go out of your way. Like, let's suppose they come in and he goes in there and they start making like underhanded comments about black people.
Yeah.
I don't think that he should sit there and take it. I don't think that you sit there and you're like, yeah, you know, my people are bad. Like, no, you don't do that. You stand your ground.
No.
Keep your head up high.
When I first went to Sarah's house, when I first went to Sarah's house, she goes, you know, there's going to be a big dinner with my brothers, their kids, my grandparents, a bunch of neighborhood people. This is in Louisville, Kentucky.
Jesus.
And then she goes, well, let's go get coffee. I went to get coffee. We came back, and I walk into the living room. I'm not kidding you. The whole place is, they have Asian lanterns. They put up bamboo.
Wait, what?
Yeah. And everybody was wearing kimonos.
Okay, now you're joking.
I'm not kidding you.
No, you're joking.
No.
Kimonos?
Yeah. And then they had me wear this kid Pokemon t-shirt.
Yeah.
So I put it on. And everyone was at the dinner table with chopsticks, and we're all laughing like crazy.
Oh, so okay.
All right, so it's a joke, right?
Yeah.
Right, but it's kind of, it's really funny.
But that's sweet,
But there's, I could be, right, two different kinds of Asian guys. Number one, this is hilarious. I love the sense of humor. Or, God damn it, this is offensive. Mm-hmm. Right, and I could have had a bad attitude about it, right, and said, you know what I mean? Take the, you know, whatever it might be, right? But it's how you deal with each situation.
No, I get what you're saying, but
I don't think you do.
Yes, I do. I know my friend Elliot. Same thing happened to him. Loved his girlfriend of 4 years, but never met the parents because the parents were just really not the types of racist that you sway. They were from the South. They were just fucking racist. It didn't matter what you told them. They were going to stick to their guns about how they felt about black people. And Elliot was not only a fucking super stud football player at Texas, but he was really well-spoken, kind, just a fucking lovable dude, right? And even in her mind, she just couldn't bring him home. They were that They couldn't be swayed. So in your case, it's a little bit different because I feel like her family probably isn't racist, Bobby. She might have had family members that had a little archaic thinking.
What I'm saying is this, though, okay, is if I meet, let's say you're white, okay, and you say, yeah, my parents are racist. In fact, they're affiliated with, you know, the Klan.
Yeah.
So which means there's no way I could probably sway them. Mm-hmm. It's not, I shouldn't be dating you.
Yeah.
I don't want that in my life in any kind of way.
Yeah.
And so if this black guy's, their parents are like that, then get out of the relationship.
My guess is because she's bringing him home,
argue against that.
Dislike the person because of their parents.
Yeah, they can't control their parents. You're right, George. But my guess is this.
Like the sons of the sons of sons. What are you, the Old Testament Jehovah?
Oh, baby, he's going to attack you.
Yeah, you do do that.
You do kill the sons of
sons. Oh, yeah, you do do that.
Look, my guess is this. For this kid.
No, stop. Okay. Stop for a second. You just made me very angry. Oh, God. Okay. It's just that if you have a jihadist, right? And he's married to a female that's a jihadist, Al-Qaeda, and they have a kid. Generally, that kid is going to become a jihadist.
What's your point?
My point is that you know what you breed, and it's like you know, you are what your environment is. Right, I've never seen. I bet you money in the history of, like, a jihadist, a kid doesn't grow up and goes, you know what? I want to be a Mormon. That's never happened. You think that's happened?
That's exactly what happened to George.
What do you mean?
He's not more. Yeah.
He grew up with a very religious family. He grew up Seventh Day Adventist.
Yeah.
And he's exactly pretty opposite of that. He's not. He's pretty.
He still has Seventh Day Adventist's mentality.
I know, but there isn't.
I mean, like, and like he likes Gary Johnson and weird shit like that. That all stuff, I don't know what it all means, but it's a part of that whole fucking weird shit that he grew up with, all right?
Back to this kid's question.
What was happening?
Crazy person. My guess is if she's bringing him home, she must know that they're not like the super racist types.
Yeah.
That they're probably, you could convince them that, okay, you know, they're probably not as racist as others, you know?
Others, yeah.
Yeah. I think that's all we have for this week, guys. Bobby has his headphones off. So
you have two options, Miles. Those are your options. Bobby's way or Khalyla's way.
What is that?
What shows do you have for Bobby?
Bobby will be at Helium in Portland, October 13th through the 15th. And the following weekend, he will be at Punchline San Francisco.
Ooh.
And those are all the dates I have for right now. I do want to, where is that artwork, Bobby? Talk about it. How amazing is
George
that?
George actually commissioned that.
Yeah.
Shout out to George Kimmel. He's in the room.
We just got a poster, a commissioned poster.
Who's the artist, George?
Richard Kulwick.
Richard Kulwick. How do you spell his last name?
K-O-O-L-W-I-J-K.
Boom. Oh, cool. Is he from Sweden or Norway?
Holland.
It is a fucking masterpiece.
Wow.
It's beautiful.
It's fucking
beautiful.
We
just received artwork from Richard Kulwick.
I love it so much. That's what I'm talking Kulwick. About.
Amazing stuff. This is fucking amazing.
Amazing stuff.
Maybe can we somehow, will he allow us to post it on our Instagram? Yeah. This is pretty fucking badass.
It's amazing.
Yeah. Good stuff. And I look at the printout of Eskimo Fuckers.
I love that too.
That's a good one.
I love it.
The colors just make me so happy.
Khalyla's holding up our 50th anniversary.
Our 50th anniversary one.
Charlie's still in it.
So it's interesting how she it's interesting Charlie's how she put.
Everyone's
okay,
part
who's
of
that?
It.
Who's that? My brother?
Okay, so this is your brother.
That's Steve. On a unicorn?
George. You know, this is your brother right here.
Oh, that's
this,
Steve.
This is
Gilbert.
Naked Gilbert. That's Asa. Eric Griffin is some. Oh, that's Eric
mushroom.
Griffin.
He's a mushroom.
Oh
my God, it's so fucking funny.
And that's you. That's
and
me.
Then George's nutsack is on Khalyla's head.
Oh my God. Yeah. You're sitting on my head, George.
It's amazing. Let me look
pretty
at
good
it.
Artwork.
It's really good artwork.
You can follow us. Anything you want to say us to the live podcast people that came?
Oh, yeah. Thank you guys so much for being super cool, super chill, and just, you know, for spending time with us. That was really.
We'll do it again.
It hit me in the heart.
We'll
know?
Do it again.
Yeah, that was very nice, you guys. And thank you for all the gifts. Still trying to finish some of the mangoes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We had a lot of gifts. That was really nice. All right, guys. That's all we have for this week. Any other announcements, Gilbert?
I'm going to pass that to George. Anything, George? How are we on iTunes charts? Are we almost at 500? Did you guys do it?
We're trying to reach 500 reviews.
Let's see. What number are we, though, in terms of the level?
We go up and down.
It goes up and down.
We're still in the top 150. Don't worry.
Yeah.
Oh, you care now.
I've always cared, bitch.
Oh, God. So he cares after all about
the
charts. He
does. Secretly cares. All right. Follow us on Instagram at TigerBelly or on Twitter at TheTigerBelly. Mm-hmm. And you can also email us any questions for unhelpful advice or just questions in general or just words of whatever. You can do that at TheTigerBelly@gmail.com. You can follow Khalyla at
Calamity K on all forms of social media.
And you can follow George and give him his support and defend him against Bobby's ridiculous wrath. George_Kimmel or voted best tweets, one of those. And you can follow Donald Trump at Gilbits. All right, bye.
See you guys.
So right now, I'm not bringing her into your world.
All
right. Just to that's keep things safe, because I want to make you...
That's fair
you're gonna
enough.
You're going to meet her in person, and then you can
No.
If I
don't get to know her now, I don't ever want to know her.
Then Khalyla will know her.
Why am I acting like that? You're right. Yeah. No, you're right. Sorry, baby. Sorry.
That's why you introduced her to mommy first.
I apologize. Which I did. I'm in a...
You me hanging?
Sorry. You had a weird paw-like hand.
Because, look, guys, I apologize for my attitude and where I am. I'm just going through destiny withdrawal.
How's it with you? Have a to-go Xbox?
No, we have a rule now.
Mm-hmm. Ooh.
I don't play on Tuesdays and Thursdays, and I didn't play all day Saturday when Trials of Osiris was going on, and I couldn't finish any of my gold tiers. I didn't get anything, but it's fine. I'm going through my Destiny withdrawal.
We just hit a compromise. He just can't play Destiny two nights out of the week so we can have a movie night. Well, that's not 5 days out of seven. It's pretty fucking good, Bobby.
But why would
you don't
skip,
need to withdraw.
Why would you skip Osiris Saturday?
I don't know why, but I knew that she was mad at me, so I didn't play.
Ooh, interesting.
Well, it started Saturday, and then Sunday, he goes, you can play, and then we made a negotiation.
We did. We struck a deal.
A deal. But I'm going through destiny withdrawal. Mm. So I might be a little bit off kilter. Is that a word?
Off kilter is fine. Yeah, thank
you. That's fine.
Okay, so I wanna first off say that I think that I'm the only friend on this side that's your girl.
Uh-huh.
And she seemed like a girl we could hang with. Very nice, well-spoken, really seems to care about Gilbert, and she's cute. Like, why wouldn't we be happy for him?
I'm already happy for him.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I am too.
We dated.
Can you at least do this for me? Mm. May I see a photo?
Not right now.
Whoa. Why?
Okay. No, don't look
she
at
doesn't
doors.
Have social media. Right
one, she doesn't have social media.
You see, you don't.
She doesn't. Also, me single... talking about. I don't even want to talk about her on this. Yeah.
That's fine. We're not talking about it.
What? You can't.
We're not.
That's
about
fine.
It.
Show me a picture and also put it online.
No, I'm not putting her online. I don't want to talk to her. I'm just saying as a friend, mm-hmm. may I see a picture.
Maybe after.
Maybe,
no,
maybe
no,
after.
Now.
No, not no. now. Because no. you're not the only one seeing it right now. The whole yeah. world, the people that are not my friends in the internet.
Oh, you mean this right here?
Yeah. So
no, that's what I'm saying. I was going to hide it. I was going to just put it on the thing. I'll go around. I'll look at her. Yeah. And then I'll come back.
Take my word for it. She's
my
a cute
girl. My girl can meet my friends. Not people looking at this camera.
Yeah. That's fine. See? He has his own rules about his life, sweetie. No, we don't
you know
have
what?
To.
You know what it is?
Don't no, go off kilter right
I'm
now.
I'm not going off kilter. This is what it is, okay? Maybe we're not there yet.
Maybe not.
I don't think that we're there yet as a family.
You're just a very cruel captain.
I'm not a cruel captain. I'm a good captain.
Called us shit things.
You call us shitmates. Shitmates.
You, call, yes, you start at the top, called us shitmates, all of us. And you blew George up.
I understand that. But sometimes the captain, right, has to talk to the crew that way. Mm-hmm. Right? Because of the stuff you just did.
What's up?
I'm not going to show you a picture of my phone. Of my
I'm
throat.
Protecting someone else.
Yeah, but I'm not. Okay, fine.
Bobby?
We're not there yet. None of, we're not just... here yet. We're not there yet. We're not there yet.
Okay, we're not okay? there.
We're not
then
there
we're
yet.
Not
we're
there
not close.
There we agree.
We're not close, right? We'll have to reevaluate the whole thing.
Okay.
We reevaluate right? this friendship?
All of it.
But we had such a successful birthday last
oh,
week.
Oh, last week.
Whose birthday was it?
What was that? Oh, my God, Bobby.
Whose birthday?
It was our, your shipmate's birthday.
Yes, our
first, it was our ship's birthday.
Our first live podcast.
That we haven't talked about it yet.
No, we haven't.
So this is the podcast.
I want to say this. May I say something?
Yes, mm-hmm. you may.
What a surprise. What a night. I went to a place that they held auditions for some sort of industrial film for some Southwest airline thing. So that you walk in and there's people signing up to audition. And we had our podcast in an audition room. Mm-hmm. So when I first showed up there, I was going to...
You're grumpy.
Grumpy. I was going to mm-hmm. burn the place down. But when I walked in, it changed everything. And it made me feel gleeful and really excited about
what did
what
you
we're
see?
Doing.
What was it like
walking
in the room?
I saw a bunch
room?
Of people that really liked our podcast. And that... it makes me want to cry right now, but... You know that. And then, and the podcast was fun. I got to talk to people and whatnot. Mm-hmm. And then this weekend, I was at the new Levity Live Comedy Club in Oxnard. And these two kids from Long Beach who are TigerBelly fans showed up. And I took them to Denny's afterwards. But mm-hmm. the reason why I did is because anybody that listens to this podcast is just a different fan than regular fans. They're more family than other ones.
How great was every single person in that room last week?
Awesome.
I mean, everybody was just
amazing.
Fucking amazing, kind, and yeah. fun. And they were funny.
Funny.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
and they were smart, and they were just very like interactive. And, you know, yeah. some there were a few that were introverted, but you can tell.
We don't breathe enough as a family together. When you breathe, that's when you know you're alive. Life is a fantasy. Welcome to another episode of TigerBelly. I am your captain, Captain Bob. We do have shipmates, Khalyla Kyun.
Did you say shipmates?
She said shipmates.
I said shipmates. Khalyla Kyun. Gilbert and George, let me say something right now. Life is a fantasy, and I'm going to tell you this. I, as a family, I just feel like we don't need to carry around baggage and resentment and hatred in our hearts. I feel like this family is going to work if we just were clear about how we feel about each other. Mm-hmm. I don't want anyone in here. You know, have you heard of the term flower shielding?
Yes, we.
I think an episode is called Flower Shielding.
Yeah, Flower Shielding.
Can we recap right? though?
Yeah, I don't want to see your face and see a smile, but in your heart, there's anger. Okay? Mm-hmm. And I know for a fact there's someone in this room right now that has something to say to me. And I don't like the fact that. that this fucking bastard comes into my house, you know what I mean, with resentment and anger, and he doesn't say anything. He smiles as if we were all good. We're all good in the hood, dog. I'm
trying to figure out who it is.
Yeah. And I want to say, I'll just call it out. Georgetown, USA, has something to say to me, uh-oh, and he's not saying it. And I'd like to hear it before we get into this fucking podcast.
Would you like him?
So go to the fucking mic right now.
Yes.
Yeah,
George.
Get on the mic, Stanopoulos.
Prepare this time, George Stopoulos.
Because also, I want, before you say anything, George, watch what you say and watch the tone, friend.
Also, can I just say, you have to allow the man to speak.
Go ahead.
No interruptions.
No interruptions.
Let him say his piece.
But then, how about this? Once he says his piece,
yeah,
I have to say my piece. And no one interrupts my fucking piece.
Okay.
Because I'm the captain.
Sure.
Go ahead, George.
Firstly, let me say, you're a good friend, Bobby.
Thank you. Well, you know what? Already, you lost. Already, you lost.
You know, let me tell you a story of back in the day
when I
first came to L.A.
Yeah.
I was a little aspiring producer. It's long before, like, I'd produced videos that had gotten billions of views on YouTube.
Oh, whoa.
Number dropping.
I'd worked with the top new media stars.
And ooh, like Kasim G. Wow. Kasim G. I had no idea. I forgot.
I was a little
He's not even SAG.
Hey, no interruptions. Let him speak. You're already roasting him, and it's
I know, but he's not even a part
of
any union. But anyway, go ahead. Go ahead.
You know, I was a little unpaid intern at Will Ferrell's company.
Oh.
Wow, just, okay.
You know. I was a...
Go ahead.
I know. And I met a girl there, like, you know, and as guys do when they meet a girl, like, I found out she lived in my neighborhood. I invited her out to drinks, you know. It was a Wednesday tradition, Berrigan's. It's no longer there anymore.
Uh-huh.
But they had $2.50 margaritas, and this was a pretty good time to, like, invite girls to. So she came to this $2.50 margaritas night, Wednesday night at Berrigan's.
Uh-huh.
And we had a great time. We were just chatting. We had so much in common. We were both aspiring producers. We bonded over French New Wave films. We both had master's degrees in producing.
Oh, well, okay.
And then my friends showed up, my good friends. You know, I think they should probably, like, act like good standing humans.
Uh-huh.
You know? My friend Steve, a lawyer. My friend Dick, a doctor, probably. And their significant others as well. Dick's wife, Steve's girlfriend at the time.
Mm-hmm.
So they show up. And instead of joining us as a group, they stand about 10 feet behind me and this girl.
Mm-hmm.
This girl's back is to them. And they proceed to start saying, "Hey, George, hey, George." And then doing this symbol. If you can describe it.
Okay, yeah. What George is doing right now, he does a little, like, a little okay sign with a hole, and he takes his other finger and sticks his finger in the okay sign. Are you saying that that's sexual penetration?
Yes, that's what they were trying to...
Okay.
That's the semaphore they were doing I was trying to chat with this girl. Yeah. Instead of joining them, I thought, like,
because where I come from, I grew up in the circus. It's it's a tiger running through a circle of flames.
Oh.
Yeah, I grew up in the circus. But anyway, go ahead.
So I keep on trying to, like, make sure, like, the conversation keeps going with this girl, so she doesn't turn around and see them, like, every time they're like, "Hey, George,
can you
George.
Stop for a second? Just stop for a second. I'm not interrupting you. I just want to say something to Khalyla."
Yes, baby.
Can you look at me right now?
Yeah, baby.
Look at me. I don't know if I can deal with this shit.
You have to, come on.
I know, but Steve, look at me right, baby. I'm on the fucking precipice of snapping.
Don't snap.
All right.
Go ahead, George.
He hasn't said anything.
I know, that's what I'm saying. So, it's about to happen, and I'm about to fuck. Oh, go ahead.
So, I thought I avoided her seeing anything of my good friends.
Just doing that.
Yeah, being very childish and...
doing the chuk-chuk sign.
Yeah, being very...
Yeah.
Very insensitive to me. Like, we were getting along great. This, I don't know. I might have had a great time with this girl. Who knows?
They were being obnoxious, basically. Yeah. Yeah.
So we all go to another bar. She said she's had enough to drink. And so I walk her to her car. About a week later, I text her. No response. A couple weeks after that, I call her. No response. Mm. I think maybe she had seen my friends.
Uh-huh.
You know, being good friends. And actually very rude friends.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. Basically cock blocking me. A couple months later, I finally
it's not
I finally
it's not, you know, cock
Email her. No response. I'm like, okay, this is not means. Going anywhere.
So, he doesn't even know what it means.
As my good friend, so as I like to say, Bobby.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Yeah, okay,
you two are a good friend.
Right. Whoa.
Oh, you're
because white rage.
Here it is.
White rage. Go ahead. Calm down.
Last week, you may have blown up my personal life, and there is a subset.
Yeah, yeah.
There's a section of the female populace who might not like their personal life to be on blast, and in order to have a relationship with me, they might think, oh, Bobby's going to put me on blast. There are many people that may
let him finish.
May not like this.
Let him finish.
And so thank you, Bobby. You're,
so you're
a good friend.
So you're saying, George, let me get this straight. The gist of your story is you thought Bobby was a good friend when he just really cocked
you. He's just like all my other good friends.
All right, so look at me right now. Look at me right now, my friend.
You're like all my other good friends.
So what happened? You blew it up. He ruined it for you. The girl no longer wants to speak with you. I mean, doesn't want to be in a she just wants to be friends now.
I'm just saying there's people out there that may. There might be a large group of people. Who knows?
George, this is your problem. When you try to confront somebody about things, be explicit. What did Bobby do wrong? Did he fuck it up for you?
You blew up my fucking joint, dog. God damn.
There it is.
Sit back down. Sit back down.
Yes, sir.
Okay, go ahead. Oh, this is right here.
Your piece. What's your piece?
There's no piece.
Oh.
Okay. Number one. And I'm stating.
Why is he stating?
Yeah. Number one. Right now, I'm stating facts.
Okay.
Okay.
Facts. Okay? Last week, let me ask you a question, you fucking got you, my friend. All right?
My fucking good
friend.
Did
you know I was going to fucking put you on blast last week before the podcast?
I thought I may have been a little friendlier.
Yeah, did you? Look at me right now. Did you know that I was going to talk about it?
Great attorney.
Before... the fucking podcast.
Do I know what you're going to say exactly?
No, but you know what the content of what I'm about to say. Right?
You might go further than ever imaginable.
But you already knew what I was going to do. So let me tell you guys something right now. Last week, I said that, you know, he's been hanging out with Khalyla's friend, Jessica, who is in Korean, a geishin, a monster.
That's mean.
It's not mean. That's fine. All right? If you look at a fucking toad and you don't call it a toad, and he says I'm a Wolverine, you're a toad.
Yeah, you're not a Wolverine.
Exactly.
You're the only one who ever says that. What? She pulled some major, major grade A dick.
Which is, you know, there are mysteries of life. They do TV shows based on mysteries of life.
The Loch Ness Monster.
The Loch Ness Monster and whatnot. Thank you, Gilbert, for fucking backing me up. All right, but there are mysteries of life. Now listen to me right now, okay? You already knew I was gonna say, okay? And number two. You are not, and this is what I'm trying to teach you, friend. All right. Right now, I'm being I'm a prophet. I'm your fucking prophet. Okay. And don't roll your eyes, bitch.
I didn't roll my eyes.
Don't roll your eyes, bitch.
My mommy saw you.
Right, I want to say this. You're not a closer. And I've been watching you for years. You're not a closer. You can open the game, but you don't know how to close. And I'm teaching you how to close. I want to tell you a story, my friend. May I tell you a story? A long time ago, I owned a skate store. Did you know that?
Yeah.
It was called Juvie. It was in Silver Lake. All right? I was part owner with my friend, Callisto. Mm-hmm. One day, I'm working in the skate store, and this girl walks in. Beautiful girl. Skate girl. And I go, this right here. I like this girl right here. Right? So I took her to dinner, got her number, and whatnot. Okay? And then, like, a week later... I go, fuck, it's not, I don't feel it. So I gotta take it to the next level. Mm-hmm. So I took her to Vegas. I took her to the Vegas with a bunch of friends of mine. Mm-hmm. Okay. And this is when I was on drugs. Mm-hmm. So this is over 14 years ago. And I drank, I took some ecstasy. I didn't know where she was. And I opened up the closet of my hotel room and my friend is fucking her. In the closet. I shut the closet and I went back to sleep. I didn't yell at my fucking...
I want to say that it's refreshing to see a guy like George who's not pretentious, who's not trying to pull any games, who's actually coming off and actually courting somebody in a very... old school kind of way. Not pushy, not aggressive, not angry when she says no. And I can really, really appreciate how he's gone about this. My only constructive criticism about the whole thing is I know my best friend. And my best friend is a tough nut to crack. And she's very feisty. So you almost have to manhandle her in a way where she's like, where you're like, look at me. Look at me.
Yeah.
Not in an aggressive way, but in an assertive way, in a calm assertion. Because
she's an animal.
I'm an animal. Her and I respond. George, her and I respond to very similar ways of being approached. And it's not in any way like aggressive. It's just really fucking assertive, where it's like, I know my place in your life and you ought to see it too, type thing. That's my only advice, my only tip going forward. I think I would be happy, I said this before, for her to date someone like you. But we gotta feel it in our groin. We gotta feel that fuel, just wanting to fuck our loins, to wanna jump out at you.
Yeah.
And you don't do that without by being meek.
Bobby just spit on his hand and touched Klaus.
Yeah, yeah. Now listen.
So nasty.
What does this say? What does it say? What does the sticker say?
It's your sticker that says I declare war on your pussy, sir.
I declare war on your pussy.
Enough said.
War. That's actually a good thing to take away.
And let me say something right now. You have anything else to say to me? That's all you're saying, long form? Is that all you have to defend?
I mean, I was in the situation on this podcast early on. Get your spot blown up. It's hard to do it when your spot's blown up.
Oh, speaking of which, let's blow Gilbert's spot up a little. He went to New York.
I know. I'm not done with this yet, but I will get into that. Okay. You also had another situation where some girl came along at one of the show. Like, you know what I mean? Remember that one other girl?
Oh, I didn't like her.
I didn't like her either.
Let's not blow
her spot up. I'm not going to blow her spot up. But what I'm saying is that I feel like he is, it's a thing with him.
Yes.
To be in friend zones and not closing a deal and having drinks. No, you have to grab them by the wrist. Not literally.
Metaphorically grab them by the wrist.
You gotta grab them by the hair.
metaphorically,
grab by the hair, the nape of the neck.
Yeah, metaphorically, and you gotta pull it back.
Metaphorically, pull it back. Yeah. Really tight. Metaphorically,
like, you're American Indian. You're scalping somebody.
metaphorically,
yeah. Right? And you gotta fucking look them in the eyes and go, take it or leave it, because I'm gonna take it.
Metaphorically.
Everyone listening.
So. That's your lesson to learn. And if I ever see you in this situation again, I am going to blow you back up again.
I want to take this moment also to say, for the record, if you ever date that girl that you brought around me that ended up hitting on Gilbert,
which
this relationship is over.
Do not talk about that.
I dislike her.
We're going to talk
so
about it.
So deeply. I dislike her so deeply for you. She is not long conning anyone. She is a con. And I guarantee you that woman to woman, I felt her vibe.
If you ever bring cons into my fucking life and our family, you have another thing coming.
She was.
I don't know why you're angry. All right.
She was hyping him up, all this stuff. And then she came to stay in George's place hit on Gilbert.
Look at him.
I don't know how to get out of this.
I'm going to blow her spot up because I just don't like her. Yeah. I don't like her for us.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, I can't tell you what to do, but like, God, don't ever bring that bitch around me again.
So,
and that is why George Kimball is George Kimball. Yeah. Long con work.
So, to wrap it up, you're forgiven.
To wrap it up, don't wrap it up.
Don't wrap it up.
But I also want you to say I'm sorry. I need to hear I'm sorry for me.
So weird.
I'm sorry you fucking blew up my joint.
There you go.
All right.
Stand your ground.
I didn't hear the second part.
Ground.
Go ahead.
Stand your ground.
So about his New York game.
No, he was what in happened? New York. Tell us about the wedding. It was your first time in New York.
I was in New York for the first time.
You've never been to New York before.
Never been to New York. Uh-huh. I was there for a wedding. And the first time ever I've been to a wedding with a date that happened to be a romantic partner. That is female, for everyone listening.
That is female.
That is female.
It's a girl that you're dating
Number
now.
Number one, Asian. So clap. Wait, let's just do a slow clap.
Wait, wait.
For that.
I thought he was dating a girl. That girl from.
From where?
She does the Soderbergh movies or whatever. Yeah. That's her. That's her.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
The Asian girl. Yeah, yeah. What's her name?
No.
Come on.
No,
just can we do a slow look, clap? Because remember in the beginning of the podcast, he had never dated.
No, look at me before
girl.
You go on your rage tear
right
now.
I'm not going to rage.
Because
I'm not
look,
I'm not raging out.
I heard you say this at Agahasi. Was it Agahasi?
Agassi Gopchang.
You said, we were talking to George. You're like, look, if you bring a girl in my world, just.
Friend, you know why? Because I didn't claim that shit yet.
He didn't close.
I didn't close the deal. And when the deal is not closed, it's not my product. Okay?
Also, women aren't.
I'm using it in a business analogy. Mm. I'm not saying that women are property. I'm saying they're all human beings. We have flesh and bones. We have spirits and souls. Okay, that's what I'm saying. All right.
Love,
but what I'm
love.
Saying is that you right you take too long. You don't close the deal, and that should have been yours. You don't ask a girl, hey, so I met this other girl. I was wondering if where this is going. She's gonna be like, nowhere, dog.
I think you're wrong.
No, you're not wrong. I'm not wrong. Oh. Tell him how I closed your deal.
I was like, hey,
there is no reason on God's green earth that I should be dating her. There's no, it doesn't make sense in life. It doesn't make sense to the universe or God or anything else, but I did. Tell him.
I said, hey, I don't think I'm ready to be in a relationship and I'm actually leaving for London in 2 weeks. He was like, nah, bitch. Nah. You're my girl. You're my girlfriend. Yeah. You ain't going nowhere. And I was like, wait, what? He was like, yeah, you're my girlfriend. And I was like,
and if she would have gone, it's done.
He's like, nope.
Bye bye.
You lost.
And I just acquiesced. I said, oh, yeah. I am? He goes, yeah, I've been telling people for a long time you're my girlfriend, so you're my girlfriend.
Yeah.
I was like,
okay. I mean, she probably made a bad mistake. This could have been not the best life for her. But she's in. Okay. So look at me right now, my friend. Look at how fucking angry. Look at his red face.
He's pretty red right now.
Right now.
He's pinker than pink.
He's pinker than pink.
Yeah.
All right. Which is red.
which is red. Okay. I really like you, man. I do. We talk about you all the time. We go, God, aren't we lucky to have George on our team? And you used to come to my shows. You deal with all the like the stickers, mailing them out, and I don't even know what's going on. You do everything. That's why this podcast, I'm splitting it four ways down the middle. You know, I know that I'm the bigger star here, and don't please don't argue against that.
No one's arguing.
All right, I'm the biggest star.
Khalyla,
listen, no look at me right now. In fact, I want everyone to say it. You're the biggest star. Everyone right
on
now.
On the count of three, all
yeah,
together.
Oh, yeah.
Bobby Lee, you're the biggest star. Here.
I didn't hear George. Now, George, you say it on your own because I didn't hear you.
Bobby, you're the biggest star.
Okay, thank you. Okay. And don't ever drop Kasim G's shit in my fucking room again or any YouTube star. I respect them, okay? They're my peers, but don't threaten me with that stuff. Okay.
You done?
Go ahead. I'm not done yet.
Okay, go ahead.
But I just want to say that I'm sorry.
Oh, now you're sorry?
No, I'm sorry. Here's what I'm sorry about. I'm sorry that you reacted the way you did.
Okay.
And I'm sorry that you didn't close the deal. And I'm sorry that right now you're going to grow and you're going to be a fucking man one day. But you're not a closer, and I want you to learn to be a closer.
So
that's it.
Mean.
And that's the end of the story. You have anything
George?
Else to say, George?
I have something to say.
Defend George.
I have something to say, too.
Friend.
I think
you
that,
do?
Yeah.
To defend I want to hear this fuckface's thing. Friend.
One, George is a man.
He is a man. Okay. Very much right, so.
Stop. Two, how do we know he's not doing the long con?
Fuck a long con, though. You don't get your dick wet with
what
a
if
long
he's
con.
Not, we don't know. If he could probably get his dick sucked all the time. We don't know that. What if he's trying to go like, I want the girlfriend?
No.
No.
Then if that's the... I usually can tell if a guy's pulling a long con.
I've seen pictures of his... You've seen pictures of his
long cons. Long cons generally do not work. It's not... It's science.
I would actually agree. It doesn't work.
Cause
I was,
it doesn't
I don't think
work.
He knows what a long con is.
What, you mean?
Yeah.
I used to do long cons.
I used to do long cons.
Yeah, long con is when you meet a girl, you're attracted to her, you know, you go, you know what? I just want to hang out with this girl and I'm going to take my time with it. You know, but you know what a lot of that is fear. Mm-hmm. It's fear of you not making a move and to get rejected. But the thing is that the problem with the long con is long cons always turn into friend zone.
Always.
Almost always turns into friend zone.
And then when she...
And when you're in the friend zone, it's almost impossible to get out.
It is, mm-hmm. yeah.
Because once somebody's in the friend zone, because I've been in friend zones and I've also seen other people in friend zones, mm-hmm. you have to then... To save it, mm-hmm. you have to do the reverse. Cut them off completely.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, guys. Can you grab me a tissue? My left nostril keeps leaking and I keep wiping it.
Fucking gross. Jesus.
I keep wiping it like this.
Yeah.
I think I have a deviated septum. Only my left nostril keeps leaking. I have I now want to say something about George.
Okay, go ahead.
Go ahead.
Here you go, babe.
Oh, it's black tissue.
Yeah, go ahead.
You want to see that white snot all over that?
Yeah. Sorry. I'm totally Donald Trumping with my sniffing.
Nice.
I